Good morning. Yeah, starting with the talk track today, the product security team wants to post a report of an exciting incident that happened earlier this year. Who are we? My colleague Johannes Segitz, lead of the proactive part of our product security team, responsible for audits, design reviews, and so on. And myself, Markus Meissner, distinguished engineer, subject matter expert for security and certifications and related things. So usually if you think about product security, you are not thinking of the word exciting. You don't want the word exciting in product security because it's always a bit stressful if that happens. And in the beginning of the year, it looked like just another year. Begin of March, we had the problem that the kernel people issued a lot of CVEs, but it just more stress. But end of March, it became interesting, and we want to present about that today. For you that have been part of the internal SUSE OSCC open source community since talk that we held, the talk will be very similar, but I still invite you to our workshop that is today in the afternoon at 2:15 in seminar room 1, where we'll be talking about mitigations. So let's begin. I plan to report this along the timelines that happened, go into the technical details of that, explain this a bit more in detail. Then afterwards, Johannes will show us a very short demo and most importantly, our learnings from that whole incident and what we can make out of that. So there is no final learning from it, but yeah, we will go into that. No talk about supply chain security like this can avoid the infamous XKCD graphic here, slightly adjusted, that we are all built on a, or all walking on the shoulders of giants or small pieces of wood in that case. The reality even looks worse. There are small of these little pieces on the basement. But today we'll be talking about the so-called compression library and tool XZ. And it turns out it actually is or was just such a small piece down there. So how did we see this from the SUSE timeline-wise? On March 4th, our package maintainers picked up that there is a new major version of XZ, the 5.6.0 release, promising speed-up improvements, various nice things. So as usual for Tumbleweed, we picked this up. It went through the integration, was good, and was checked in on March 7th and released to our Tumbleweed users. So all our Tumbleweed users got it around the March 7th date. There was a follow-up update with bug fixes that entered Tumbleweed on the March 17th. And until then, no one was suspecting anything. So on our side, it was just nicely integrated, working nicely so far. No one suspected anything. Around 3 weeks later, after the initial check-in, I received a message from a colleague that is also part of the Debian project that Debian was informed about a potential backdoor, looking into one of the M4 files of the package. I forwarded this to our product security, and some colleagues that were still working started to look into it. And on the morning of the first day, March 28th, we verified the Spectre report. And it soon turned out to be kind of complex, well hidden, and multi-stage backdoor. So we then started mitigation measures. The first one was that we reverted the XZ version in Tumbleweed to the previous 5.4.6 version. Also, our build ops team and also some other colleagues like Dirk started to do a trigger full rebuild of Tumbleweed against a previous snapshot without malicious XZ in it. At the time, we didn't even know what it exactly was doing. We were just kind of sure that it was doing some bad things. on the whole March 28th, we prepared in parallel the communication about it We also verified that our enterprise products were not yet affected. That would have even caused more necessary work and QA work and so on. So we prepared a lot of the communication, and on the evening of the March the 28th, we received then the first evaluation report from Debian across our embargo distribution coordination lists, where they told that this hides a SSH backdoor. At that time, really, we already had pressed the big red button, involved all our processes, triggering these kind of high impact vulnerabilities mostly with communication focus here at this time, because only Tumbleweed was affected. Yeah, March 29 saw a lot of communication review, and in the evening the issue went public, and then the long Easter weekend started. What is not here is that, of course, after Easter we started follow-up work. We will go into that afterwards. Parallel, looking at the outside timeline, other distributions like Debian Unstable and Fedora Rawhide, who follow upstream closely, had updated to this. Interestingly enough, Debian had a known maintainer update, NMU, and it turned out that I think the original 5.6.0 or 5.6.1 was triggered actually by also one of the attackers, as it turned out. Interesting enough, also Fedora saw regressions from 5.6.0. We did not see regressions. And the upstream offer worked with them to disable the functionality temporarily and release 5.6.1, which turned out to fix the backdoor. we all reverted back to the 4.5.6 version on the first day of March 28th. So there's a nice graphic, so I don't need to go into that on my own. So first, we thought that this was actually someone whose account had been hijacked temporarily. So someone stole GitHub credentials and just released a malicious release. But soon after looking at the Git logs and looking a bit when was something introduced, it turns out that at least half a year before was spent on that. And looking deeper into that, it turned out the whole persona that was working there was actually a malicious actor. So the militia, they created their GitHub account the first time in 2021. They looked for, did some small contributions to various open source projects, apparently looking for projects that would accept new contributions, new maintainers. So they submitted to libarchive, for instance, and to one or two others, and except they found someone where they could easily become a maintainer. So the maintainer of Xset was at this time only a single person, a lone person, and he was also overworked at that time. So it was kind of a ripe undertaking to inject themselves. So they joined the Xset, the first commits were in beginning of 22, and he soon also became co-maintainer, and in mid of 2023, so 9 months before the backdoor was actually shipped, the first infrastructure was added to create this backdoor in Xset library. And on the final pieces were committed in the midst of February and then released beginning of March. So that's if you have ever looked at malicious actors, that is a very long time of such a malicious actor working on such a topic. A bit on the technical details. So the outside visible thing was only this M4 script and in result the configure shell script coming out of that. And if you looked ever at autoconf M4 scripts, they are barely readable. And the changes they did was looking very similar to the regular autoconf M4 macros, so that a cursory look at it, I need to spend like 15 minutes to see what actually the problem was in there. Because it was kind of well-crafted, well-hidden. They tried to obfuscate it in that shell script even, so that to avoid a cursory look. So what it does, it takes one of the test suite files, actually, replaces some characters, and decompresses it for a first-stage loader. First-stage loader is another bash file, now less obfuscated, that takes yet another test suite file, decompresses that, and then in turn has a second stage bootloader, or not bootloader, but backdoor loader. And the second stage file actually builds the new .o files and inserts binary backdoor into this .o file and hooks it into the into the libLZME library build, including decryption. So the first time, it was quite obvious that it was very sophisticated backdoor. We did even start to reverse engineer the actually binary only object file that they included, but that also was kind of obfuscated. So we were really not making this on a single day evaluation. Fortunately, Debian, the colleagues from Debian also, and others then over the Easter weekend looked at what was the backdoor doing. So it is built into the library of XZ, libLZMA. And what they were looking for is that SSH loads libLZMA into its process. And it does that in patched OpenSSH, not in the standard upstream OpenSSH via libsystemd. OpenSSH uses libsystemd for login notifications. And that was a distributor patch that we, Debian, and Fedora include. It has some anti-debugger detection, like is common for malware, so like debugger detection, interactivity detection, kill switch detection. And in the end, if everything is detected to be okay, then it hooked into an OpenSSL function called RSA public decrypt, and basically looked for a key passed in from the SSH remote or from the SSH client, and then acted upon that. passing a payload and then executing code within the context of the root SSH daemon. So leaving no traces, running no unnecessary processes, so really quite well hidden. The only problem was that this whole thing took quite long due to the symbol lookup that they were doing. It took like 0.3 or 0.4 seconds of time. So that's the actual researcher that found it, Andres Freund from Microsoft, was able to see this as a performance regression and so in turn found the backdoor. The reason it took so long is that it used a very interesting method of symbol lookup to avoid importing any kind of symbols, because that would have shown up on debugging or on ELF binary inspection. So they used the LD audit functionality from glibc to look up the functions. So to avoid any kind of detection. What was positive in the whole reaction? Yeah? So we reacted quickly. That was so really on noticing. Next day we were able to revert on Tumbleweed. We could reliably go back. That is also something, because if we would not have been able to rebuild Tumbleweed with a known good XZ, we would have been kind of in an untrusted state. I'm not sure if we used slow roll snapshot or some other snapshot for that. I don't quite remember, but at least we were able to do this easily. We actually, so if you're wondering if the backdoor was active on Tumbleweed, so yes, it was. So we actually verified that there were 3 weeks of backdoor presence in Tumbleweed. The cross distribution knowledge sharing in the incident here was working quite well, both via the embargo distros list, and they also involved the third wins portal. And there was a lot of communication happening that was also working quite well. And the good thing is that our commercial offerings and OpenSUSE Leap were not affected, as they have some delays in taking software. Yeah. You might think that is years, but yeah, at least months. So here we were kind of lucky that that was detected after 3 weeks of presence on the outside. Might have been bad for SP6, because for SP6 we might have planned to update XZ, but fortunately we did not. So looking at the overall summary, this attack was really well engineered. Yeah, you saw there were 3 years of planning of that, and the discovery was really just by chance. And it is, I think, the most sophisticated we have seen ever, or in the last years at least, in the open source community. In a binary-only community, the SolarWinds attack was probably worse, but not many. But in the open source world, that was probably the worst or most sophisticated scene that we had. It was made for a specific attacker, including key verification, so that it was not just a generic wild shot, but it was really made by some specific attacker. Long-term planned, executed, and also intended for long-term usage due to the well hiddenness. So if you ever wondered how a nation state attack against open source looks like, this is it. Yeah, this is one of the methods. Others might use very different methods, of course, and we need to think about those. But this likely was, or likely would, is something like a nation state attack would look like. And interesting here is also that they used social engineering. So they put pressure on the open source project maintainer. So there was a SOC puppet account, the user that only had no other contributions showed up once and told the exact maintainer to accept this persona, this malicious persona as a co-maintainer. And also another SOC puppet used for introducing the version into Debian quickly. Yeah. So and really the time spent by this person was really over several years, including also good fixes. So and this and including that the big backdoor was hidden in the big feature update makes it very hard to detect. So to summarize, currently we have nothing to protect us or our ecosystem against that. So that in turn led to immediate thinking, of course, of brainstorming, and about that, before we go into that, I would like to hand over to my colleague Johannes for a demo.
Okay, thank you very much. So, I actually wanted to show you the demo live, but it turns out I cleaned up my VMs and deleted the backdoored VM, and we did a really good job of deleting everything that was backdoored. I also did not want to put the backdoor back on the build service, so I will just show you the video demo. And let's hope that the audio also works, so let's see.
To be a rather quick one, so there is a nice GitHub repo that provides a Python script. And what it does, it basically checks for the existing key that is in the binary itself, and then it just patches the binary and adds a key that is known. So you do it like that, you just provide the path to the library, and once you ran that, you have a known key in there, so now we are able to actually exploit that. And if you look at our system logs here, I added a couple of new lines to show you that we will see nothing here, but there is this command that then allows you to execute code in here. And I just run the ID command and pipe it to a file on my system. And while this kind of looks like an error, it's not. This is the expected output. We now see that we were actually able to execute code as root. And if we go back here to our log, we see that we don't see anything. So that's a very nifty and nice backdoor. And of course, now we are able to play around with that. But without the key, you don't see that it's used on your system, and also it's very hard to scan for because you can't really remotely scan for that.
Yeah, sorry for the video quality. It looked nice on my screen. I doubt that you were able to read it unless you have really good eyes. But also, it's not that important because you just have to know the key, then you're able to execute any code. By now, we also know that this backdoor had a lot of functionality, including interactive login. But from a security point of view, I don't care about all of that. It's just game over at the point where an attacker can execute code as root. So very powerful backdoor. So while Marcus said that we don't have anything to protect against that, that's obviously not a really great state for us, so we did a follow-up on that. In general, solutions don't really have to be perfect. We really rarely have any perfect solutions, but they need to work against an adaptable and capable attacker, and that is a big problem. That's the reason why, for example, antivirus does not work, at least signature-based antivirus. Because if I, as an attacker, want to attack a system, I figure out which AV solution they use, then I adapt my backdoor until it does not trigger via the signatures anymore. And we will have a very similar problem with our defenses. So We need to be aware that they will know what we are doing and they will adapt to that. And it's pretty clear that this is a group that is well-founded and also very capable in what they are doing, so we can't expect that they are stupid or anything. It also needs to work in an open source world, and that's quite a challenge, because we all here work together and we want to keep it that way, but in the end you would need to act as if other people were malicious constantly, and that's really tricky because that's just not the way how humans work. So if you work with a person for 2 years, then you trust that person after a while. And obviously they managed to exploit that. In general, we will not have like one measure that solves that. We need to have a collection of measures that then just increase the likelihood of detection. And also technical hardenings will play some part, but they will probably not be the full solution. So there's not one compiler flag that we can enable or one scanner that we can run and then we're good. But it's again just increasing the chances of detection over time and then hope that we actually detect it soon enough. We will also have different groups that need to work on that. So of course the security team within SUSE, but there are also other teams within SUSE that need to work on that, development teams, packaging teams, and luckily we have pretty good security knowledge within the company. So that is really a big bonus, because if you are in a different company, then you know that a security team sometimes can be pretty scary. And then SUSE as a whole needs to help here. So for example, funding for upstream, something like that, that is not something that we on a technical level can do. Of course, we also need to think about if we as a community player can do something, not only SUSE, but also the open SUSE community. Are there ways how we, for example, can work together with different security teams? This is something that we need to figure out over time. Is there anything how we can avoid duplication of work? Can we maybe build up on a common base? These are all things that we need to consider. And then, of course, the open source community. First of all, you all need to be aware that you are targets. No? Everyone that is able to do something significant with a code base can be target of social engineering, or that someone just steals your accounts or somehow tries to subvert your work. Yeah? This is not theoretical anymore. That can definitely happen, and we all need to up our game here. No? But then again, we also need to be realistic about what we can do. It's not like we can go around and like take over every struggling upstream. So we need to be very wise with the effort that we can spend. So we have that URL here. You can also scan this code. What we did in the company is that we did a supply chain brainstorming after the event, where everyone could just dump their ideas there, and then we had a little bit of discussion here. I talked to everyone that did this, because we did this originally within Confluence, and now we publish this on the OpenSUSE wiki so that all of these ideas are public and can be discussed in the community. We then had follow-up sessions within the product security team where we evaluated these ideas and decided on like half of them that we would assign people to actually work on those. So over time, we want to drive them further. And you can see that in the table, because it has a so-called workstream lead or something similar assigned. So if you're interested in a topic, just reach out to the person and or just work on the stuff, submit something, or take one of the topics that not have been assigned. As Markus already mentioned earlier, we will have a workshop later on, because this was just to lay the groundwork so that people know what happened. But we want to take input from the community on how we can actually solve that. Because by now we did not have like this one crazy idea that solves everything. If you have that, come to us, please. The brainstorming document definitely is recommended reading. So please have a look at this if you want to join the workshop. I know it's a pretty big document, but it should be sufficient to just read the summary in the beginning of an idea. And if there's anything that we did not consider, then please talk to us. We will present what we did, and also we'll try to go in some promising ideas. And again, your ideas are the things that we are looking for. This is not something that one security team will solve. This is something that is a challenge for the whole community, and it's also a challenge that will stay here. These people earn a lot of money by attacking source or by attacking software in general, and they learned that attacking the source code is a very promising way, because if you manage to build a backdoor like that into the sources, then it is much more stable and you can sell it for longer. Something like that is worth many, many millions. So people are also well incentivized to work on that, and we need to work on that constantly too, otherwise we will lose this struggle. Well. Okay, with that, thank you very much. And do you have any questions? And we have a mic there that will be can be used for that. And if we don't have any questions, we have that workshop later on where we will be in a bit more familiar situation, not in this stage situation. Okay, then we can go.